Oi, 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 it's another Pit Stop Podcast!
Oh, welcome back to another one!
We're doing it again. This is like the third one this week, isn't it?
Well, this is going to be the episode on a Monday, so people are listening to this on Monday morning.
This is Monday's episode.
You may have just woke up, you're going to work, you might not know what the day's going to have for you, but it's going to start off with a Pit Stop Podcast.
What a great way to start Monday, because we are joined by yet again another guest.
And I'm excited about this one, because we've just spent the last 2 hours at the bar. Had a couple of shots. That's the Euler Bar in Royal Docks. Fantastic
Don't
bar.
Don't disclose the location, bro.
Why? Why?
Because we live here.
That's okay. I don't mind.
I don't know.
Free shots, beers, a lot.
Yeah, thank you, Yanni. Thank you, Yanis. Thank you, Bree. Legends. However, we do have a guest with us today. This guy is... So we met this guy in Amsterdam. I don't want to spill too many stories, but we met this guy in Amsterdam through a mutual friend, hit it off. He's a great guy, and he's now sat on our sofa opposite us. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Matt MD, I'm going to call you.
Absolutely. Thanks, boys. Thanks for having me. You cannot believe I'm here. Did not think I'd be doing the most relaxed podcast. Nice little loosen up before. It's great. Yeah, fantastic. I'm excited to be here.
Go for a beer first was the absolute perfect thing to do. Especially considering we met over a beer.
Absolutely.
Let's start with how we met. That's definitely the best way to do it, because me and Fabs were sat in that restaurant. And we were literally texting Brad at the time.
We've told this story, right?
We've told it.
I'd love to hear it from your side. Like what?
Yeah, so it was an interesting one. So me and Brad had known each other really well. So we'd decided we'd go for a beer and a catch up, as we do for most races. And the weirdest bit about the story was we'd picked a restaurant and we couldn't get in. So Brad was like, right, I'll find another place, which he picked and booked. And on the train in, he went, oh, I'm just not feeling this restaurant. I'll book somewhere else. So he booked this third place, which was a steak restaurant. And we've wandered into the steak restaurant and we sit down eating, and it's interesting listening to your pod before. He's gone, I'm sure that's the Pit Stop Podcast boys over the corner. And I've gone, no way, they're in the, like, there's no chance they're here. And sure enough, we've sort of eaten our food, and next you know, Brad sort of stood up and had a look, and sure enough, it's you boys. So we've wandered over and he's like, fancy a few beers, and we've wandered over to you boys, see if you fancied a drink.
Fuck yeah.
And it went from there. But yeah, it was so random, the odds were so small.
Do you know what's so random? We'll get into like what you do and let everyone know what you do at some point, but the craziest thing for us, and I don't know if we've told you this yet, but you do look a little bit like Max Verstappen.
Someone said this before.
You were Max Verstappen when you were sat there, because we were like, oh, it's definitely Brad, because he sat with Verstappen.
We saw Brad, and Brad was like, yeah, I've got someone joining me from, you know, Formula, like we're going to have a dinner. So we're like, okay, we'll leave you to it. Like, no worries, we'll let you crack on. Yeah. And then you walk in. We didn't see you walk in, but we saw the back of your head, and you have a very similar back of your head to Max Verstappen. I was like, he's got fucking Max with him.
Love that. Sorry to disappoint though. Yeah.
Oh man, that's so funny.
It was good. We had a fucking good night. We had a few beers and
that's the night you got robbed.
It was the night I got robbed.
We needed these boys with us.
Was it?
Yeah, it was shortly
after
that.
It was the robbing night. Yeah, it was the robbing night.
We could have really done with the physios.
Yeah, we could have done just to like make sure my skills are on point in the fight.
To be fair, five of them, two of us, we were fine.
Yeah, we were good. Why don't you tell the people what you do?
Yeah, sure. So I am a performance coach in Formula 2. So I look after Yuma Wasser, who is one of the Red Bull juniors.
Sick.
I've looked after him for now for 2 years. So we started originally in Formula 3 and we're now up to Formula 2. And yeah, it's good. So my role kind of is a mixture of very similar to what you'd have seen from the podcast with Michael and Brad, is that we provide physio and training support away from the track. And then on a race weekend, our job is pretty extensive in the sense that we are just managing that driver from start to finish. They just drive the car. We look after absolutely everything else.
Mad.
Yeah.
That's mad.
Yeah.
So we've had Ollie Caldwell on, who's F2.
Yep.
Apart from that, I don't know if we've really had anyone from the F2 on the podcast.
No, we haven't. But we actually love watching the F2, don't we? We always watch it every week.
We've really got into it. And now that we know that you're doing the things of Wasser and that, we have
Yeah, because
like,
we were watching it this weekend.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And I know you two were texting throughout. And I was watching it and I was just thinking, you're there, that's your driver. And obviously there was a bad crash at the end of qualifying.
Yeah. But it's mad racing. I think the thing that what's exciting about F2 is the car, unlike F1, the F2 cars are all the same. So we can change some aerodynamic setups and we can change the suspension setups, but as a whole, the cars are the same. The engines come from the same factory. The bodywork panels are the same. So the cars are pretty identical. So it just comes down to the drivers and they go hard. They've got nothing to lose. They've got everything to prove. And I mean, this weekend was a great example. We had 8 cars that DNF'd, crashes, bold moves, you name it, it happened. So it's great racing. Yeah,
that's
really
the beauty
good.
Of the lower formulas for me is like everyone there has got the goal of being in F1. So they are going to push it as hard as they can.
Yeah.
Like arguably maybe even push it harder than an F1 driver would, because in their car, they're like, I have to perform here.
Yeah.
Because I want someone from the F1 to look at me and be like, I want them to drive for me.
Yeah. And it's been exciting for us this season. I mean, the thing we've seen as well is a lot of these drivers are really young. So as the season goes on, you see them develop as drivers. So you see some guys that have perhaps had a slower start to the season, start to get experience and have really strong finishes. So you see some huge changes. I mean, our championship at the minute, Drugovic has just won, but from positions 2 down to about 10, completely open, interchangeable in the last two races.
That's what I realised, because I know Wasta was running at 4th, right? And then after what happened at this last race, where is he now?
So we're now 9th. We were P4 after this race with a podium finish this weekend, but we got disqualified. So that hit us hard in the points, but you know, there's still a matter of 3 or 4 points between 3 or 4 positions, so everything is still to play for.
That's fucking mental.
It's tight, yeah, super tight. So the pressure stays on us for sure, right till the end of the season. Very bunched up pack, so yeah, it's exciting. Yeah.
Let's go way back though. Like, we could easily pod and chat about this for ages. We love F1, love F2, but let's just quickly go back.
Oh, we got to dive deep.
You leaving school, how are you now? From school, working with someone in F2, traveling the world, living a job thousands of people would like to do. How have you done that journey?
Yeah, good question. I sometimes wonder myself. Physio, I did a degree. So I went to university, did my physio degree. I was a bit of a busybody. Twitter, social media kind of got in the pockets of a few people who I knew were fairly influential in the physio world and was kind of lucky to kind of be taken under their wing. In our medical world, there's certain boxes you have to tick. So had to work in the hospitals and kind of, you know, build up a bit of experience. But alongside that, I've always worked in sport. So I actually worked in professional football, first of all, with Norwich City. So I was there straight out of uni. So I managed to work
With the team?
Absolutely. So I was with the under-18s, the under-23s. So a lot of the boys you now see in the first team were kind of my
players. That's unreal.
Players.
I've got mates that want to do that.
It was unbelievable. Great experience. And again, it kind of gave you a little bit of credibility to kind of start moving through the different sports.
Yeah.
And I went into private practice fairly quick. And Brad, who you had on your previous podcasts, I've worked with Brad since.
Oh, we know your mates with Brad. Yeah. Don't worry, the stories are coming later on in the podcast.
Yeah, so we've worked together for many years. I then went into gymnastics with Brad. So we've looked after Team GB now. It's been my third year of looking after Team GB. So we've done the Japanese Olympics. We've done the Commonwealth most recently. So yeah, from there, we've kind of built up. So yeah, it's been a kind of crazy whirlwind of a career, really.
What did you want to do when you were younger? Did you always... Because to be honest, I feel like no one in school, when they're really young, I'm talking primary school, no one goes, I want to be a physio. Like, it's not what I'm talking about.
Maybe not you and me.
No, come on. In year five.
Someone who's interested in sport.
Year five, when we're not that far off the same age. In year five, you wouldn't have gone, I wanted to be a physio. Yeah. I wanted to be a policeman. So what did you want to be when you were younger?
Yeah, because I think, so originally, if we go way back, when I first started, I wanted to be a pilot.
Nice.
Yeah, pilot.
So now you're
thing.
On the private jets. Real
pilots are the heroes of the
real
world.
Real Top
man.
Gun kind of stuff. And yeah, I wanted to be a pilot. And it all came crashing down for me when I went, applied to the RAF. And I remember sitting down and the guy went, how tall are you? And I was like, oh, I'm 6'3". Thinking, yeah, that's a, yeah, must, it can only be a good thing, right? But I was too tall. And they went, you'll never be in a jet. So after that, at 16, that kind of plummeted that dream for me. Yeah, wow. Park that. Yeah. So after that,
but that's good in a way, because you realize, right, fuck, I can't do this at 16. Yeah. What's the next step?
Yeah, absolutely. So after that, I come from a very medical family. Sister's a GP, mum's a nurse. Yeah. So the medical route for me was one that I was always interested in.
Yeah.
And actually, believe it or not, dentistry, let's do dentistry. I don't want to be a doctor, so let's do dentistry. And I did some work experience and absolutely hated it. It was the most boring job I've ever sat and watched in my life. So after that, I played a lot of sport, played to a good level. And I think like a lot of physios.
Is that like football?
Yeah. Believe it or not, I played a lot of rugby.
Rugby?
Played rugby and played squash. Bit of a niche.
Nice.
Bit of a niche. I know.
Any paddle?
Any paddle? No.
No paddle?
Played a bit, actually. Funny, at Zandvoort, we played a little bit of paddle. But no, paddle was never, in England, it's not really a thing.
I didn't know what they were saying.
I don't know what paddle
fucking
was. How
embarrassing. We had the two Ferrari drivers on. They're like, we played paddle? I was like, what the fuck
what
is paddle?
Yeah.
I remember we went to Spa and then we stayed at this hotel and it had a paddle court. So I remember walking in, because they looked like a tennis court with walls around them. So basically a squash court. and just thinking, what the hell is this? Great sport to play, but in England, it just doesn't exist.
No,
but
I've never heard of it. Oh, I have seen the videos on TikTok of it and people doing the crazy shots and like they jump out the door and that and they like swing the ball round. We should definitely give paddle a go.
Yeah, maybe. One sport at a time. We're trying to learn golf at the moment.
Great sport. We've noticed everyone sucks at golf. It's just, yeah.
Yeah, but everyone in F1 plays golf, so we hear.
We've heard it's a good like talking point. Like if we're able to be like, oh, we'll come for a round of golf with you.
Yeah.
But we can't hit the fucking ball. So we've told everyone we can play just so we get invited to the golf days. But we can't actually play.
It's going to be so embarrassing when we show up.
Golf's a great sport. It's just so technical. I feel like nobody... I'm same as you boys. I love golf and I love having all the gear, but I'm definitely have absolutely no idea.
Yeah, all the gear and no idea.
Exactly that, yeah. I'm there for the beer after and the chats. Yeah, that's it, yeah.
Well, it'd be a great... For us, I think it'd be good because if we all got mic'd up, like we could do an extended podcast with these guys like while playing
love
golf.
That.
I'd love to get like you, Brad, like Callum, get a load of the guys together and just all do a pod together like love on that. The golf course. I think it'd be unreal.
Yeah, long round, but I'd definitely keen for that, yeah.
That's definitely the best thing about this pod because we own this pod and we can do what we want. Like, if we have these ideas and the guests want to do it with us, we can just meet up at a golf course, text, make a WhatsApp group.
Yeah. Love that.
Like, and you don't get that from any other media that covers the sport. Like, nothing else is that personal.
Yeah.
To have that personal connection within the sport is, I think, what makes Pit Stop so special.
For sure.
And I do just quickly want to say to the people listening, it may have only been 14 minutes into the pod, but this weekend, okay, at the time you listen to this, me and Fab will be in Switzerland. Fab, we are filming with pretty big people.
Yeah,
eh?
we don't say who, but
you
we're
don't
going to
say who.
We're going to Switzerland. If you guys are into the F1, then you might be able to figure it out. But we can't say anymore.
We won't say anymore. You'll have to wait for the pod. But we're filming with some F1 drivers. Okay, back to the podcast.
So gymnastics. Then what's the step from there onto the F1?
Yeah. So F2. Gymnastics, I still do. So I still look after Team GB. I have a guy that kind of covers me when I'm away, but that's still something I look after, which is great.
Because you are away a lot, right? I mean, you guys travel fucking.
That's absolutely definitely mad. Something. I'm just going to jump into that from the people listening's point of view. If I'm a listener to that, I know because we've spoke. But I'm thinking, how do you have the time to work with gymnasts, other people, and
have a family and have a life?
Yeah, like, honestly, good question. I think, honestly, it comes from a love of doing what we do, for sure. Like, we live and breathe what we do. Like, yeah, so working a 70-hour week is normal. That being said, you have to manage a little bit. So I have a guy that works with me that kind of helps me look after Team GB, which is super useful. I was that guy to Brad. So when Brad used to originally first started going into F1, I would look after Team GB while he was away. Yeah, absolutely.
So
yeah,
wait, you and Brad actually worked together?
Absolutely.
So at one point, you and Brad were what, on the same athlete?
So what we used to do is, so we would, Team GB, we would do two clinics a week. So Brad would do the Tuesday, I would do the Thursday, and we would kind of team up on that. And then if Brad was away, I would do both days and... Yeah, it would work like that. So, and then
is that how you met Brad?
No. So, after I'd sort of done some of the stuff with Norwich, I actually got into a private clinic. The private clinic was three of us, a guy called John, myself and Brad. That was the three guys at the clinic. So we would see the general public for any physio problems they had. And from there, Brad went into GB, took me with him. We worked very similarly and it worked really, really well. And that's kind of how I got into racing.
I feel like we need to shed some light on John.
I was going to say,
what the fuck is John doing? Who is John and where is John?
John's fucking like washed up.
Hello, John.
So John started the clinic originally. John, and I don't even talk down. John's amazing. Fantastic physio. He just manages the clinic. He's unbelievable physio. He's great. Yeah, so he's kind of the one who kind of keeps holds down the fort while me and Brad sort of play around the world.
You guys are sipping the beers. He's sat at home running the emails. I like it.
You boys have a really important job. Like, I mean, you fucking work extremely hard at what you do, but with like hard work comes hard party, right?
We try. Yeah, absolutely. We have our moments.
Yeah, I know the Formula One world is sort of renowned for the parties that you guys get into, but the one thing that we noticed going away and doing these races that like, you guys party fucking hard. And then the next morning you get up and you carry on doing your job, which isn't like an office job. You don't just go to work and sort of like sit at a computer, like brain dead. You got to be fucking on it.
Yeah.
So like, what is that like? Like living
Yeah,
that
you
life?
Have to, you have to pick your moments. It's hard because your job's quite intense. We have early starts, late finishes, particularly in F2. We have earlier starts than F1. So we have to be, quite mindful.
Yeah, because you're always on before.
Exactly that. So we have to be a bit mindful of that. But yeah, it's full on schedule, but you just kind of have to pick your moments. Similar to some of the stuff Michael was saying, that you try and lead by example. So big thing is around kind of nutrition, sleep, etc. with the drivers. So do try and generally lead by example. But if there's an opportunity for us to kind of have a bit of a social, you know, yes, take a bit of time for yourself sometimes and enjoy the moments when you can get them.
I find it weird, like, I guess we're so new to this world and we got really lucky and like we love Brad and like we're so grateful you wanted to come on this pod. But at the end of the day, we're two guys that 6 months ago didn't even watch the sport. And then out in a bar, you know, we've got Max Verstappen's coach coming over to us with you. We hadn't met you. And then for the next 3 hours, we're at a bar having beers together before the Grand Prix weekend. It's crazy how the sport has changed and we've been able to step into the space and meet this. But it's all about who you know within the grid. And that's where I say to you, like, do you think... Oh, I don't know how to word this question. Do you think you want to stay in this space for a long period of time? Like,
yeah.
Do you feel like this is the beginning of your journey and you want to work your way up through the formulas?
Yeah, great, mate. It's a great question. And I also have to, I'm in the same shoes you guys are. Like, I've been in the game for, it's my second year. So there's times where, yeah, I mean, my role is amazing. And don't get me wrong, there's never a second that goes by or a different round I go by where I don't pinch myself and think, oh my God, I can't believe I'm here. And some of the situations we get ourselves in where you're just pinching yourself and you're in a really privileged position because often, you know, fans are looking in and you're kind of going into scenarios where they're like, oh my God, you know, I'd love to be in that scenario. But, you know, from the inside, I'm still thinking that. So you sometimes have to pinch yourself. In terms of the longevity of it, like for now, I'm loving it. Yeah, I'm enjoying the ride and kind of just kind of seeing where it takes me. I think I'm in a really privileged position whereby, you know, I'm young and haven't got too many ties whereby I can travel the world and not worry too much. Mm-hmm. It's hard for sure, you know. Having a girlfriend at home has to be super understanding. That's difficult. And I think, you know, I think for a lot of guys or girls in the sport, when they start having families, it becomes increasingly difficult to start saying, right, I'm going to be away for 200 days of the year.
Yeah.
So for right now, I'm loving it. Yeah. And if anything, I look at it to me as a bit of an advantage. You know, I can commit to stuff that other people can't really commit to. So I'm, at the minute, I'm trying to climb that ladder.
And you feel like if any opportunity comes up, like you're fucking ready to...
Absolutely. Yeah, you've got to have your eyes open, ears open all the time.
It's just exciting. Yeah. Like, I love the fact you two were texting when the race was on the other day. And like, obviously the crash was bad, but luckily it was all right. And like, we saw the picture of the car that you posted.
But it's just mad for me because we'd be at these races, right? And we're there. But then when you're sat at home and you're watching it on TV, it's almost like this untouchable sort of like,
that's what
I'm... like it's just on TV and then you're texting me and I know that you're there in the pit lane as it's going on.
And it's weird because I always think when you're in the pit lane, it's so normalized and it's like so nice. Us chatting the other day and I often talk to some friends at home and, you know, like it's sometimes just nice to have these normalized stories. Like we're chatting away about the crash and like, oh my, isn't it unreal? Yeah. Whereas sometimes it's so normalized in the pit lane, you can't really talk about it. It's just that's what's happened that day. So it's super refreshing sometimes to chat about it in that context.
Cool.
But yeah, it's madness. The whole world is so fast paced and there's so much going on. It's just, it's never a dull weekend.
I also think it's really important for the listeners to be able to hear this side. Like I actually love our podcast. Do you know what? I've actually started listening for the people at home.
Are you a fan of the Pistol Podcast?
No, I know this sounds crazy, right? But I didn't listen to our own podcast. I've always hated stuff of myself.
Yeah,
I can't listen back to it. Mm. And I've also, one of the reasons I didn't do it is because I never wanted to repeat myself. If I never listen to it, then I know I haven't heard it again. So if I say it again, it's natural. Because I can't remember anything I've said. I'm looking at the screen now, be filmed with 22 minutes. I can't remember a fucking thing I've said for 20 minutes.
Nah, not a fucking thing.
But I've started listening. I listened to one we did, we literally filmed it yesterday of Mark Priestley. Legend, amazing episode. And I can actually kind of get the grip now of why this podcast is a bit different. Because we are giving a voice to where you wouldn't normally hear.
Yeah, yeah.
But I definitely want to stay in this paddock. Like when we go on these weekends away, we get mad lost. Like so lost. We were saying to Mark when we go away, he said he did it for 10 years. We forget about home. Like when you're there, do you just get, are you so in the moment and you forget about home?
Do you know what? It's interesting that. And I think on a race weekend, 100%. Like the minute we get there on, typically for us, a race weekend starts on the Thursday morning. So when we first get to the track.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's talk through your F2 start to finish, leaving the house race weekend.
So different to F1 is F2, we have slightly less there's less money. So our weekends look slightly different. So we would typically fly
out.
We had a private jet from France to Hungary, actually, the other week. My first private jet.
Boy,
the cherry went. That was good.
And then we're back to Ryanair.
Well, the funny story is we got a private jet from France to Budapest, and then we got a Ryanair flight back from Budapest to home.
So better than EasyJet.
Swiftly down to reality.
Better than EasyJet, I must say. Yeah. Ryanair's not too bad.
Controversial.
No,
like
we'll promote
that,
whoever gives us free flights, Babs.
Oh, yeah, we love EasyJet.
You're all great for now.
We love EasyJet.
I've spilt a beer.
Beer's gone over.
But yeah, so a race weekend for us, we'd typically travel on a, as long as it's a European, we would typically travel on a Wednesday. If it was further afield, we would travel on a Tuesday. So if it was any of the Middle East, we would typically travel. So Formula 2, for reference, is Europe and the Middle East. We don't do any of the Americas, Australia, Brazil.
Yeah. Why is that?
Do you know why?
I think it's a funding thing. I think it's a money thing. Yeah. We do Bahrain, Saudi. We were going to do Russia until that got pulled. And then the rest of our events are all Europe. Right. That being said, next year we're supposed to do Australia. And that's cool. So we do 14 of the 22 F1 races.
I see F2 growing big.
Yeah.
I still think F2 is... Because you got to think, the amount of people that love this sport, you've only got 20 F1 drivers.
Yeah.
Admittedly, I think they'll add another two. There'll be 22 on the grid.
Hiccups.
But I think the next best thing, I actually love watching F2 just much.
Oh, mate,
F1.
No, they're very close-knit, because any F2 driver is going to go into the
F1. Well, that's the thing now. They're working towards that.
Yeah, and you look at a lot of the F2 drivers, a lot of them are test driving F1 cars. You know, this year, I think we've had quite a lot of publicity of some of the F2 drivers doing FP1 sessions for F1 teams.
Oh, it's mandatory now. They have to.
And that's part of the regulations, actually. It's so, Liam the other week for AlphaTauri.
Nick DeVries was doing it for Aston Martin.
Absolutely. So they're getting more publicity. So it's definitely growing in size, but the race weekend for us is quite interesting. So we get there on a Thursday morning at the track. That is a day of setup. So for me, that's quite a quiet day. I would set up the driver's station within the truck, get everything ready for the driver, make sure that when it comes to the race weekend, we're ready to hit the ground running. So everything's prepped, ready to go.
Is he there at this point?
Absolutely, yeah. So on a Thursday, the drivers are having a lot of engineering meetings. So they're chatting kind of strategies for the weekend, getting car set up, signing on.
And if you want to talk to him, you just WhatsApp him.
That's
the boundary I want to break on the pod. They're the questions you wouldn't know. So just WhatsApp and be like, you've got to be here now. Like,
exactly that. Yeah. So I always think we have our paddock is slightly set back from the F1. So we would have a massive tent, which got the cars in it. And then we have a truck. In the truck, it's got two levels to it. The bottom level is kind of quite functional. The top level is a meeting room and the driver's room. So that's like a little private room. So my job on a Thursday is the driver might have some media. So it's quite a relaxed day for me, getting the driver's kit set up. But if he needs to do something, I'll text him. Mm. You need to go for lunch. You need to go for this media meeting, you know, drink some water. I'll look after him for that day. It's quite a relaxed day for us. And then Friday comes around. So Friday for us, we have free practice and we have qualifying in the same day. So that's a busy day for us. Figuring out the car setup. Yep. Saturday we have a sprint race, so like you've seen in F1 for some of the races, we have that every race. So that is so that's quite an interesting setup.
I have wondered every why race every time
you have a sprint.
Yeah, so that is on a sprint race we have after
it's
the qualifying
reverse.
Exactly. So positions 1 to 10 are reversed.
I love that.
Yeah,
I've always wondered why every time I watch F2 there's a sprint, and now you've said it's every race.
Yeah, is that why the points are so close?
Yeah, absolutely. There's less points available for the sprint, much less points available, but it levels the playing field for sure. Mm. And then we have the regular feature race, which is based off qualifying.
But the sprint
on
doesn't set the race.
Has no
grid,
impact
does it?
On the
qualifying
race.
Sets the race.
It's purely points, right?
And I think it's an amazing opportunity for drivers to show how good they are, because if you reverse the grid from qualifying for a sprint every weekend in F2, I actually think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
It's cool.
The other thing with our qualifying is it's much shorter than F1, so we have half an hour. So
and everyone's out, isn't it? And it's just who sets the fastest time.
Exactly that. So sometimes it gives a good opportunity for the guys who perhaps have struggled to show what they can do from the front. But I also think that's what it's great for, is showing a bit of driver character for if you've had a great quali, right, let's put you in 10th. Let's see what you do from 10th. Can you work your way through the field in an identical car? What have you got? So it's a great format. It's really, really exciting. Yeah, it's great. And I love the sprint races. You know, there's no tire changes. It's flat out it's yeah, all guns blazing, see what you got.
I was going to say, what are you doing with during qualifying? But during qualifying, you were texting Fabs. So.
Yeah.
I'm guessing you were just standing there waiting for
just chilling.
The setup's quite interesting for us. So unlike F1, our pit lane is away from the F1 pit lane. But when it comes to qualifying, we have to basically be mobile because we are in the F1 pit lane for all of our sessions.
You're just like outside the garage, right?
Absolutely. So the F1 teams, if you ever spot them, we all have quads. And on the back of the quads, we have racks of tires, air compressors.
The nose cones. I've seen them driving through.
Through Barcelona.
I've seen them driving through where there's like all the nose cones and everything.
Exactly that.
And everything.
Yeah. So we have to be mobile to the grid. So it adds an added complexity in my role in the sense of I have to make sure on me. You'll always know an F2 sort of performance coach or F3 performance coach from an F1 because we've got tons of stuff on us. We look like we're going camping for the weekend.
Yeah. well, the old stories of like, you know, Brad was saying how, or it was Michael, like forgot like one of the gloves.
Yeah, two little
like
gloves.
Brad with the visor in
there. So for us, that would be, I wouldn't say race over, but I mean, me getting back to the pit is often a 5-minute, 10-minute
You've
job.
You've got to fucking sprint that.
Yeah, you're done. Yeah, I did it. The only time it's interesting, I was thinking back to actually, I've not had any muck-ups quite like Brad or Michael on the visors and things like that. My driver really likes to drink before the race, and we're in
a drink,
like of water. Yeah.
Imagine to clear that one up,
just to clear that,
just a double gin and tonic,
just to
get in the zone.
And we're in Saudi, and the pit lane is miles away, and I'm on an electric scooter to the pit lane. And as I get to the pit lane, I fill my bag, and I realize his water bottle's not there. And the worst thing is, we have a one-way radio, so I can hear the driver and the engineers, but I can't speak back. So as I get to the pit lane, I panic. And I'm like, I've got to go back and get this guy's water bottle. You've never seen a man move so fast on a scooter in your life. And all the guys, performance coaches that are coming to the grid, send me absolute shady at that. And they're like, what is going on? And you can see the looks on their faces. And all I can hear is, where's Matt? Anyone know where Matt is? And I can't talk back. So honestly, I finally get back to the grid and I'm dripping with sweat. And I've got the water bottle and nobody knows. But it was, a terrible moment.
That is unreal.
But we have to be super organized. Everything's got to be on us and ready to go because once we're there, we're there. Yeah.
And you've stepped, how has it changed from F3? Because if you're now in an F2 paddock, what was the F3 paddock like? Was it very different?
Not a huge switch. I think the only difference F3 is a lot more drivers. So it's 10 more drivers.
Is there 30 drivers
30
in F3?
30 drivers, yeah.
I thought so. When I looked at it on TV, I was like, oh my God, they just keep coming.
So every team has 3 drivers in F3, whereas in F2, we go back down to 2. So the team numbers are the same. They still have 10 teams, but they have 3 drivers per team as opposed to 2. So it wasn't too different. But it's just intense. Yeah, it feels like a bit more serious. You know, these guys are close to the top. You know, the step's not far away, so there's a little bit more pressure on everything you do. Wow. It's great. It's a good buzz to it. Yeah.
So you spend so much of your life caught up in this F1 circus. Like, I imagine a lot of your mates are actually in the sport now. Would you say that's true?
Yeah, it's interesting. Yes and no. No, I'd probably like. It's a tight-knit group, and even in your podcast, it's interesting because, yes, everyone knows of each other, but from like to form a tight-knit with someone, I think that's close. Like, me and Brad are super close, so we always try and meet up for a beer and know each other really well.
So what are some fucking crazy stories of you and Brad then? Because there's got to be a few. When you guys have been like travelling around the world together.
Well, guys, the first time I met them, they're singing beers. I feel like they must have done some crazy shit.
There's got to be some weird happenings.
I'm always grateful for Brad. Like, he's been instrumental in my career, and like we've had some really random. I mean, Joe, one of the first times I remember meeting Brad, when I was working in F3, and we'd try and meet for a beer and a catch up, and just to kind of, on a professional level, it was good to kind of bounce some ideas, how are things going, but and also just to have a catch up and whatnot. And we met at a hotel in Austria. So Brad sends me the location of this hotel, and it's one of Red Bull's hotels they own in Austria.
Red Bull Ring.
Yeah, of course. Absolutely. Yeah. So Red Bull own it. And I rock up this hotel. It's a beautiful, stunning hotel. It's gorgeous. And he says, I'm round the back. I don't know if you remember. I think it might have been the Euros when England were playing Ukraine.
Oh, okay.
We beat them 5-1 or something like that.
Yeah.
Anyway, I walk around the back of this hotel. And as I walk around the back, there must have been 6 tables set up. And on one table, you've got Max, Kelly, Christian. On the other table, you've got Checo, Albon, The Works, Jerry Halliwell, David Coulthard, the who's who of Red
What's
Bull.
What's Albon doing there?
Honestly, and honestly, I'm looking around and I'm thinking, it's one of those moments you boys talk about, like, you know, do you just kind of, does it become the norm? And I remember just sitting there thinking, what the hell is going on? Like, yeah. I shouldn't be here.
Yeah, yeah.
And Brad was just finishing dinner and he texts me and he's like, look, I'll come over after dinner. And there was a chair about 10 metres away and it's in front of the football. And I'll sit down and I'm sat there with a beer and I can just see all these big names around me. And I'm just sort of thinking, I should not be here. But I'm trying to pretend that I'm watching the football. Yeah. Not interested in anyone. And the football's going on and England has scored a couple of goals. I think it's like 3-1 England. And next thing you know, I remember Jerry Halliwell comes over and sits next to me. And I'm trying to play it cool and just pretend that she's not there. And my girlfriend's a massive Spice Girls fan. And all I'm thinking in my head is, God, I'd love to take a selfie right now. Yes. Like, sneaky snap. And she's like, then gets really excited because England have scored. Next thing you know, David Coulthard's coming over. And I just remember just being blown away by this scenario, thinking I just shouldn't be here. But yeah, it's mad. We've been super fortunate. There's so many stories, I think, with me and Brad, where we've kind of done random things. Like Monaco is another great example where, like, unbelievable.
Might
as well.
Monaco is a mad place. I remember going there.
Monaco, like, that's where Red Bull have the sick, like, they have the swimming pool.
Yeah, let's build the scene. That's the place where you see the videos.
Monaco's the place for Red Bull.
Monaco's the place to be, and I think also Red Bull's the team to work for when it comes to Monaco. They have the energy station, so that is a hospitality unit in Monaco harbour. It is phenomenal.
So that's different to, like, Paddock Pass.
Yeah, so if you can imagine you've been to the Treehouse, where Brad's based sometimes, the Red Bull hospitality unit that's based there.
Is that what it's called, the Treehouse?
Sometimes, yes, it's called the Treehouse.
What, their motorhome?
Yeah, so out the back where they have all the catering and like that, called the Treehouse, all the wood and bamboo and things like that.
We have not seen that. We've been upstairs.
Yeah, so basically it's big. So they basically put that floating on the water in Monaco Harbour.
Wow.
It's unbelievable.
It's massive as well.
Yeah, it's huge. So it has, when you go there, it's got, I think there's 3 or 4 levels.
3 floors, isn't
it? Yeah, 3 floors. You go there, you can only set the scene. You know, this harbour is full of multi-million pound, billionaire, you know, pound boats. And you walk in and the Red Bull party is the place to be. And you can hear it pumping all around Monaco.
Same as the garage.
We had heard from other people before we'd even met Brad that the Red Bull party was a place to be in Monaco, haven't we? From that geezer that was on the boat, he said, you've got to get to the Red Bull party.
You just know it. You just know it as well. It's unbelievable. Like, it's renowned, right, for it. Mm. Yeah, I think, like, because of the pool and everything else. Yeah, it's the spot.
Oh, it's amazing. And you rock up and there's 3 levels to it. And again, similar sort of scenario. I've met Brad there for a beer and I've walked in. And first thing was, I went into the football was on, I think Liverpool playing. We're in the area. Michael's there. Brad was there, I was there, and next thing you know, I'm not a big football fan, and I remember Phil Foden was in front of us, and we had Mason Mount as well, and we're just watching the football, and I remember just thinking, this is one of those moments where you're just like pinching yourself, thinking, what is going on? But the music going on, they've got DJs, there's 3 levels to the party. It's like, you've got to be a VIP to get into the Red Bull party, then there's a VIP area, and then there's a VIP area of the VIP area, and it's the most mad, place.
Yeah. We're going to the VIP, VIP, VIP area. We're going to the pit stop area.
Well, someone sent me a video of the whole promenade along the front.
Yeah.
And it's just like party every night.
Unbelievable. It's unreal. I mean, without discussing too much, yeah, there's some late nights there for sure. Yeah, and it's makes for some fragile heads the next day, that's for sure. Yeah.
Want to go somewhere we have to go.
Do you know what? I just love how, like, everything has to be a bit quiet about around the F1 that you can't say too much, but everyone knows all this crazy shit goes on.
What I laughed about was, I remember getting into the little name, you know, we got into the VIP VIP area, and I had my wristband that was like, this is my VIP wristband and this is my VIP VIP wristband. And a bit like when, you know, 18 at a festival and you're thinking, I'm going to keep this on for life. Thinking, well, that's incriminating. That's coming off. That's staying with
Show
me,
everyone.
But it's come off the next day. But yeah, it's unbelievable place. Yeah, it's phenomenal. Yeah, it's great. Really, really good place to go to.
So you're working with Iwasa
right
now. And I mean, I don't know a lot about the F2, but what I did notice is that his car is like fully branded in Red Bull. Mm. So for someone who's like ignorant, you would think that's a Red Bull driver.
Yeah, yeah.
But how does it work in that sense?
So in Formula 2, we have 10 teams. The teams are independent teams, so we don't have manufacturer teams. So Mercedes, Ferrari, Red Bull, they don't have teams. That being said, they would sponsor a driver. So Red Bull are probably the most prominent team in Formula 2 in the sense of we have five drivers on the grid. So they are in various teams.
Yeah.
Red Bull will pay a portion of the money. So a bit like your podcast that you did with Hughes.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. With Jake, yeah, there's a bill to pay. And they pick up a bit of the bill. We've got some Mercedes drivers, we've got some Ferrari drivers, but the teams independently do that. So the setup's quite interesting.
So if Owasa moves teams, let's say next year, like he'll still have the Red Bull branding
on his
car.
Absolutely. Yeah, he's a Red Bull sponsored athlete, so that would move
and
with
Red
him.
And Red Bull pay for the seat.
Absolutely.
And he's a Red Bull driver.
It will vary driver to driver, so the arrangements will be different. Some drivers might be wholly sponsored by them. Yumi, for example, is Honda sponsored and Red Bull sponsored, so between them will pick up the bill. But it will vary. I'm sure these are all behind the scenes stuff, so even I don't know, but they'll
have different
levels of sponsorship.
Could they not just have an F2 team?
I'm not sure. I don't know why, to be honest. I don't know why that might be, but no, none of the manufacturers have teams. They're all independent teams that then will have
sponsorship. Isn't the only actual official one is AlphaTauri is quite clearly Red Bull because in the motorhome, it's AlphaTauri and Red Bull and sharing.
Yeah, absolutely. But even them, all of their drivers that are in the junior program are Red Bull drivers, and they Liam Lawson recently driving for AlphaTauri, but he's obviously a Red Bull driver and they're linked. So it's an interesting setup, but the benefit of F2 is the teams work very closely together with the F1 teams to just bring these drivers up, support them as best they can, and feed them into F1 now more than ever.
Yeah. So outside of Brad, I guess, do you have a direct relationship with Red Bull yourself?
It's interesting because Brad's role outside of what he does with Max is supporting the junior program. So if any of the junior drivers outside of me had a problem, they would speak to Brad. Mm. There's another guy in the team called Lockie who they'd also talk to. So they are the main points of contact anyway. So we also have a lot of support from Red Bull. Have a what we call an athlete performance center, which is in Austria. Which is an amazing facility. You probably see someone Instagram of Max and Checo testing their neck and doing some crazy stuff.
Oh, yeah, we've seen that.
Yeah, we go there a couple of times a year, which is a phenomenal center.
Do you train like that, by the way?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah. So our training facilities are pretty identical. We train at APC. We train at Red Bull at Milton Keynes. So we've got access to all the gyms there. So, we've got just as much kit as the F1 guys. So we train just as hard, do all the same stuff. Yeah. That's identical. So we've got great support. So we've got at that center, we've got access to psychologists, nutritionists, physios. Even though we are physios, we can get a bit of backup if we need it. Yeah, you name it, we've got it. So it's super helpful.
That's mad.
Your current driver, Owasa, is Japanese, right?
Yeah.
How do you deal with a language barrier?
Yeah, good question.
Because I've wondered this.
Yeah, so when we first met in Formula 3, it was interesting, and I got the call and to meet this guy who's kind of coming up from F4 to F3, and went and had a meeting and thought his English was very average, and it was definitely a real struggle for him. But it's great. His English has come on leaps and bounds now, so he's getting better and better. The difficulty is kind of helping him to learn English a bit as well, because he's around a lot of mechanics. So some of the language can be quite fruity.
Yeah, I imagine some of the words he learns, all the fucking swear words, everything.
So you have to kind of be a bit on the responsible side of kind of teaching him where he can say certain things and where he can't, especially when it comes to media stuff and he's trying to translate into English.
He's taking all the shit the mechanics
So, I remember some of the stuff, and I don't know what I can say and can't say, but I remember the one of the funny stories about what his language was. I remember one of the mechanics had taught him the word motherfucker. And in an interview, he'd
You'll
sort
be safe with this one. Said, come on, Red Bull, let it slide.
And I remember he said about one of the drivers being a bit of a motherfucker. And I remember being having to educate him on, mate, we can't say that.
You really can't crack that out.
Yeah, exactly that. But it's interesting. The big thing for us is there's huge cultural differences in the way we train. That's the biggest thing we've seen in F2 is we're very strength and performance focused. And coming across from the Japanese training background was quite different. So that was quite a challenge. But it's 2 years now, so I think he's coming around to kind of the mix of stuff that we do now, which is good.
Yeah. That's great. The one thing that I think we've learned is that people are constantly moving throughout the sport. Just because someone has this job now doesn't mean they're going to stay doing that forever. Mm. But they're not going to leave the F1. They might just stay in the F1 and just move different roles. So, I guess the first question is, is your goal to get into the F1 and train people in the F1 and 2? If you do, when do you think it could be, or what would be your route in?
Good question. 100%. Yeah, I want to be an F1. Yeah, definitely.
I think that's the pinnacle for everyone, whether you're a trainer or a person in the garage. Like Callum said, Callum said he's working way to the F1. Mark said the same thing, he works way to the F1.
It's the pinnacle.
Everyone wants to get to F1, whether you're a photographer, whether you're a media, whether you're...
Yep.
That is the pinnacle.
Absolutely. I think, look, I think you want to tick it off. You want to kind of have a taste of it. So for sure, that's the goal. The route there, I think we all have an idea of what we think the route looks like. I think the one thing F1 teaches you is whatever you think the route looks like, it just doesn't, it doesn't happen in real life. Like, doors open that you didn't even think were doors there. Mm-hmm. So I think, look, I think you have an idea in your head of what route it would be. You hope it, you know, your drive. I mean, we've had a really great career in the last 2 years. We've gone from F3 to F2 and it's looking pretty promising. So that might be our route up. But you just never know what's going to happen in F1. It's a world that just throws you curveballs left, right, and center. So yeah, you just kind of go for the ride really and see what happens. And the interesting thing, all the guys you speak to, is you just look at everyone's career and it's just, they have no idea. You just kind of go for the ride. And a bit like you boys with the podcast, like, things just happen at a rate of knots and it's constantly changing. And you just kind of learn to just be relaxed.
You can't predict it, can you?
No. And our world is no different. Everyone thinks that, oh, maybe it's really predictable and you have, you know, it's like no other job. You know, it's not like a, you know, you talk to friends, don't you, of normal jobs, and they apply for a role and they kind of know it's their time to be promoted. And I just find motorsport doesn't work like that. Things come left, right, and center. And
but that's exciting, bro. Like, nice. I think a lot of people would be scared by that shit, but like we don't know if we're going to be able to pay rent next week. Like, that's kind of how sort of crazy we live.
The trip we're about to go on, we can't even afford to pay our rent. Like, we're aware of the fact we've got to pay rent on that day, and we're aware of the fact we're not going to have the money on
If
that
our
day.
Landlord is listening to this, we do apologise.
Like, fuck you! That's what I say to the landlord. You're taking all of our money, you prick!
We're going to try and find the money, but if we are late, we do apologise. But it's for good reason, so.
I can get less.
Yeah, do you know what? Fuck you.
Fuck the rent. Get your money when you get it.
We haven't paid an energy bill all year.
Shut up, don't say that.
I don't know how we've still got electric.
The debt collectors will come back.
I'll fight them.
F1, if you're listening, it's time to sign us. It's okay, we're going broke.
Pay up. Love that.
I'm curious to know, within the F2 paddock, whether there's a difference within, like, so you're there with a Red Bull driver. So is there a difference between the different drivers, different teams, of like level of physio or like level of team? Because if you're coming in from like I'm here with a Red Bull driver, is there people that are working for like a more independent driver and maybe their physio isn't as good?
Yeah. Oh, good question. Generally, when you get up to F2, no, everyone's got a performance coach. Yeah, everyone's got one. The levels are good. It's quite an unusual setup. There is one company that supply performance coaches to the grid. So they probably supply, I mean, there's a rough figure, maybe 60, 70% of performance coaches to the grid. Red Bull was slightly different. Some of Alpine are slightly different.
You weren't
as well.
One of those people?
No. Alpine are slightly different as well, whereby we are independent and we've got links with Alpine or Red Bull or whatever, and we then work for drivers and have been placed with drivers. But it's hard to know, to be honest. It's although, like, I know a lot of...
You speak to the other F2 physios.
Yeah, I speak to, I would say, about half the grid I know quite well, like, and you kind of chat to them, and it's not because we have a problem with them, I just haven't spoke to them that much.
Do you ever steal their ideas?
To be honest with it, no, like, not in the sense of, like, you might see something cool.
Nah,
yeah, that
really,
looks nice.
Yeah.
They were doing backflips last week.
But no, I know what you mean. It's a weird world. But everyone's dead friendly. Everyone's dead friendly. Everyone knows it's quite nice because when you go for a, you know, chat with one of the guys, you know, it's a unique job. So to be able to sympathise with the bits that we love, but also the bits that we struggle with, there's nothing better than someone else who's in the paddock. So yeah, we try and chat to everyone on the grid. Everyone's pretty sound. It's good.
What about if, like, someone on the grid, though, crashed into your driver? Would you then be mad pissed off with
it's
their
pistols at dawn,
stage?
Sure.
You know,
nah,
pistols like at dawn. Being outside the garage, right? Come on in.
I quite like it. Everyone's friendly on the grid, so you kind of have a little smirk to each other that you quite enjoy, that your lads are having a bit of, you know, a bit of grief, perhaps, if there is a bit of beef on the grid. So no, it's quite a good atmosphere between, like, the physios and performance coaches, to be fair. Everyone's in quite a good spirit. So there's quite a good bit of chat. Like, a few of the guys, you know, you'll go and congratulate them if you have a good race, but also there's good banter, in the sense if you can go over to them and be like, oh, a bit ropey today, what are you doing? So it's good. There's a lovely atmosphere on the grid. I like it. Yeah, it's good.
What have been your most, like, memorable moments of your experience in the Formula Racing? Like, give us, like, your top three, like, moments where you were like, fuck yeah, this is it, this is the shit.
One would definitely have to be our first race win, in F2. We did our we had quite a tough F3 season. We had a couple of podiums, but nothing too crazy, so to get to F2 we were really pleased. But we've come on leaps and bounds in F2. We've now had 6 podiums.
Yeah, flying.
Let's go.
Doing really well.
Sick.
So our first podium was, like, especially first, like, was magical. Unbelievable, the buzz, the kind of real, more emotional than I thought it was going to be, you know? Didn't really think I'd be that emotional about
it, but
I remember having a bit of a lump in the throat thinking, cool, it's like a lot of hard work's gone into this.
Yeah.
So that was definitely a highlight. Monaco, just without a doubt. I was not a big fan of Monaco, and then I went there, and I remember the first time being there and just being like, this is a proper pinch yourself moment. You know, I'm being paid to be here. This is ridiculous.
So
that's definitely a highlight. I think, what else really? There's so many moments, to be honest. The whole thing is, I've been there 2 years, which sounds like a long time, but like you boys are saying, you're so engrossed in it, it feels like it's gone so quick, mate. The whole thing is just, yeah.
What did you think about your first ever private jet?
Great question. I've never been on a private jet.
Like, to be honest, I'm shit scared of it because I know it's coming. Yeah. Well, I say that because you've got to manifest these things.
More turbulence.
I don't know when it's coming, but I know I'll get on a private jet at some point, and I'm shit scared of flying as it is.
It's going to be a bumpy ride,
and
bro.
They're bumpy rides, private jets. So, like,
people always think of Formula, like, we've got tons of money for about, and don't get me wrong, there's a lot of money, but in F2, obviously, we've got to cut corners somewhere. So we fly in regular flights, we stay in nice hotels, but some fairly regular hotels that it's not as glamorous as F1. So Michael and Brad's hotel has probably put me to shame. So part of the magic. So talking about my first win, right? So our first win was in La Cascalette this year in France. And we had a flight booked from La Cascalette to go to Budapest for our next race. We were going to just go there rather than go home. And we had a Ryanair flight booked. And the Ryanair flight was from France to Amsterdam and Amsterdam then to France.
To Budapest.
And we could have done, but we didn't book. And anyway, long story short, the flight got cancelled and we had to book another flight. And the flight was going to take 11 hours round trip from France to Budapest. And I'm probably not allowed to say who, but anyway, one of our team members was like, we've got to have a party. You've just won. So a driver's dad booked us a private jet.
It was Christian Horner, okay? It was Christian fucking Horner.
So we got on this private jet and it was unbelievable. So we'd gone from race win, thinking we were about to jump on an 11-hour flight. We drove to the airport in Toulon, got on the private jet and we flew to Budapest and it was unbelievable.
That is unreal.
But do you know what? You say that F1 is like that, but like, who did we have on our flight to Barcelona? We had
Jan Vos.
Jan Vos. Janet Vost.
Josh Vost.
Yeah, no, it's Jost. From Head of Williams.
Jost Vost.
No, you're thinking.
His surname is Vost.
No, you're thinking of Franz Tost. Who, by the way.
You're thinking of Adam Seagull from McLaren, you little shit.
Right, we had this thing in the other episode. He thought Zach Brown was the fucking team boss
of
McLaren. I've only just
learned Zach Brown isn't the principal.
And I said, no, it's not. It's Adam Seagull. But
it's not,
but it's not either of them.
So, funny story about Zach Brown, I've got a few boys you'll quite enjoy. So, I was at Silverstone and we have electric scooters to get between the F2 paddock and the F1 paddock. And the classics race was on. I don't know if you've seen a lot of the F1 races, they have the classics event. If you've got a bit of money and you've got an old school F1 car, you can drive it. So, anyway, I'm in the F2 paddock and I've just scooted back. And one of the girls says to me, do you mind giving one of the classics guys a lift back to the F1 paddock? I'm like, well, yeah, no problem.
What, on your scooter?
On the scooter, because it's quite a long walk. So I'm like, well, that's fine. So this bloke walks out with a helmet on. He's got a bit of a beer belly and just classic driver. Like, bloke in his 60s, driving an F1, an old F1 car.
I know what you're going to say already.
So I give this guy a lift back to the F1 paddock. And I'm like, oh, have you got your F1 pass? Because to get through here, you're going to need a pass. And you boys have seen it. It's a pretty tight lockdown to get through.
Yeah.
And he's gone, oh, no, I don't have a pass, but it'll be all right. I went, oh, no, it won't be. Like, if you haven't got a pass, you won't get through. Anyway, this bloke's then taking his helmet off, and it's bloody Zach Brown.
Oh, fuck, I thought you were going to say Mr. B.
No, I wasn't expecting
Zach Brown. And obviously, I'm there feeling like an absolute idiot.
Zach, have you got your pass?
I'll be like, yeah, you'll be fine.
Zach, there's no chance you're getting in, fellow.
Oh, my God, that's hilarious.
I couldn't believe it. And he just had his helmet on the whole time, so I just assumed it was just some old bloke who had an F1 car. I couldn't believe it. I felt so embarrassed. That's genius. Oh, God, I feel an idiot, but... Yeah, unbelievable.
That's fucking funny. That's hilarious. So he's racing these old cars, is he?
Well, I didn't even know that. I knew that Vettel had a bit of involvement. So that weekend, Vettel had his F1 car out.
His own? Wait, Vettel?
So Vettel, I think he's rebuilt a Formula 1 car from the 80s and it now runs on synthetic fuel. So the Silverstone weekend, in the classics race, Vettel actually drove the car.
Is it Senna's one?
Yes.
The blue and yellow one?
That's it.
I've seen it. I've seen the clip of him racing it.
Super
amazing.
Cool car. Amazing car.
So cool to see him in that car. Yeah. But I still do think to myself, that's Sebastian Vettel driving without a halo. I still do worry about there not being that.
Yeah, that's fucking
crazy.
Even when you see someone drive now one of the old school cars, every time I think there's no halo.
I remember watching at Spa this year. It was one of the best classics events ever, because you can, from the F2 paddock, we've probably got the best view over F1. We've got Eau Rouge. We're on Eau Rouge. So okay, our pit lane.
Well, I'm going to nod my head
Our paddock is on Eau Rouge at the base. It's the second paddock. So
Eau Rouge is the big thing at Spa. Down over the top. Yeah.
Good man.
Do you?
I got clue.
It was wet last year, and I remember watching the classics, and they're all over the show. And you're thinking, like, these cars, one, are worth a fortune, and two, the protection is nothing. And you watch these guys racing around in these cars, and it is terrifying. Just different breed, but yeah.
Would you prefer wet or dry race? What do you think is more fun?
Oh, you say that. We're quite good in the wet, so for me, I quite like a wet race. For me personally, in terms of excitement, I think the boys are they're ballsy in the dry. Yeah, like, you see some real talent in the wet, don't get me wrong. Like, the real standout drivers.
That's when you realise who's who. You know who.
That is true. In the wet, you can see who's fucking level.
I remember Spa last year, and it was Jack actually did really well doing. And in the wet, and he was phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. Tore the place apart. It was fantastic to watch. But I like the dry. Yeah, the boys go for it. Yeah, so for us, it's all conditions are good, because the racing's just always pretty exciting.
Do you fancy yourself in a car? Because I know you're a big motorhead. Like, you've got, you've got Jag F-Type at home?
Yeah, I'm a bit of a petrol head. Yeah, I get a lot of grief, actually, for my cars, because I do change quite a lot. I think I've been driving now for 10 years.
You ever got on a go-kart, tried to race?
Yeah,
yourself?
Do a bit. We actually did go-karting in Bahrain. We were in Bahrain at the Grand Prix, and we went go-karting one evening with the team, and we rocked up, and every F2 driver had just rocked up with their team as well. So there was Jack there, Ayumu was there, Vesti was there. Honestly, half the F2 grid were there, and say it was competitive was an understatement.
Well, you were racing against them?
Yeah,
That's fucking unreal.
Yeah,
that's going to be us.
I would have wiped them all out.
I came very mid-pack, which I was quite pleased with. There was definitely a front group of elite F2 drivers.
Wait, yeah, who was behind you? That's what I want to know. Who was behind you?
There was a few guys who just, it wasn't their gig you were behind. I was quite happy with a mid-fleet finish there. Yeah, I was quite happy with that.
But, was Christian racing?
No, it wasn't. It was very much an F2 gig, that.
Who was Brad racing? Or?
No, it was all F2.
We've heard that story from someone else, though.
I think you told us in the bar in Amsterdam about that.
Yeah, it was great. It was great fun. The Bahrain go-karting track was unbelievable. It's like a full replica of the race.
And it's in the middle of?
It's literally within the circuit. It's unbelievable.
Who fucking told us that?
We've heard that from someone else.
Really?
Must have been you.
It's a night circuit.
No, it wasn't. We've heard that from someone else who was racing in that race.
Really,
definitely.
Unreal. Yeah.
And they've told us it in the middle of the Bahrain circuit, but we've spoke to so many people, and to be honest, throughout the whole of Zandvoort, we were pissed. So I don't remember a thing we said to anyone.
No, all a bit of a dream, to be honest.
It's a class track. Yeah, it's great. So, no, it's good. But I enjoy my driving. I love it. I say I'm an okay driver. When you get on the track, though, you realise I have a go on the sim every now and then against the drivers, and if I can be within like 10 seconds, I'm absolutely buzzing.
I'd be up with that.
It's hard. It's so hard. Yeah. You think you're a good driver, and then you get put with the boys, and you realise you're absolutely shocking.
That's what Mark said yesterday, didn't he? Mark went go-karting with a few of the guys.
He said even when we raced with Josh.
Yeah.
But Josh is national champion. Doesn't matter that he's 12, he's going to slap us, silly.
Yeah, true. But I think if we can get the chance to actually go in, like, even... I know, because Silverstone do the F4 cars, I think, that you can drive around.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
But if we can get a chance, like, maybe Matt can hook us up to getting, like, a Wasser's car at the end of the season.
Come on,
Matt. Couple of laps around Abu Dhabi, maybe, after the race.
I know that you've been enjoying seeing a Wasser's car, because when you were texting for out qualifying and we got a little bit of an exclusive photograph, okay, no one saw us. You were asking for a gift.
Look, Matt.
And we asked Matt to bring something.
We knew Owasa had a crash, and we were like, if anyone can sort us out, like, a part of that car for some reason, it'd be amazing.
So we were expecting Matt to turn up here with a massive part of the car.
I know. I was disappointed. It's interesting. I was chatting to the mechanics, and I was like, boys, what's going in the bin? There was various bits of carbon fiber going in the bin, and the only thing that was absolutely... I mean, the gearbox is pretty unexciting, but there was this spoiler, and they're huge, the spoilers, and I thought, that would be great.
Mate, the whole rear wing. I would have put it on the wall.
I would have fucking died.
It was bent like a banana, and I thought, if I could only get that in my case, it'd be unbelievable.
Because we were literally texting at the time, and I said to Fabs, I was like, tell Matt we want something for our background, just as you'd send the photo of the car.
Anything.
I was imagining even you going up to the car and like snapping a wing mirror off or something.
So I ended up getting you, but it's disappointing, but we've got a few signed bits, got loads of Red Bull. So yeah,
a few signed bits.
Why don't you get it?
Let's get it.
Oh wow, we got a whole bag. It's like Christmas.
A Tom Ford bag.
Oh shit, this is unreal. Guests listening, if you don't bring us anything, we're gonna rip you to shreds.
We've got some Red Bull drinks. Sugar free too, because I'm watching my weight.
We've got around a bit so you move for the wall, just to boost the profile.
Thank you. Unbelievable. Glasses going straight on the wall.
So yeah, some random gifts.
In F2, we struggle for merch, but you know, we make things work where we can.
That's class.
If he gets into F1 though, I can sell
that
for thousands of pounds when I'm broke.
So you know.
Yeah, if anyone really loves a Wasser, this will go on eBay.
I've got a Lance Stroll signed card in my thing as well.
Yeah, no one's bid yet.
Between these two, if this does go to shit and I'm fucking broke in a couple of years, at least I can sell these.
Well, exactly that.
And I can buy more beer and drugs and everything else.
We've been going for an hour now. This has been a great chat after going to the bar.
Matt, it's been good chatting to you.
Boy, it's been great.
Do you know what? I'm sure we're going to have so many more because I feel like we're mates now.
Oh, we'll definitely catch up.
I love it. We're going to make our own stories. Well, that's it.
Well,
yeah,
that's
absolutely.
It. We will have that's our it. Own stories.
That's going to be the best part. Is the next time that we podcast, it's just going to be us three talking about the crazy shit.
Well,
we'll
have to switch up in a year. Maybe we'll switch the camera around and be like, right, share your stories, boys. Let's get
I'm sure there'll be a few.
We'd never be invited back if we shared us. So best we stay quiet and we stay this side. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for listening to the Pit Stop Podcast. Matt, thank you very much for joining us. At the time that you're listening to this, we'll be in Switzerland, like I said, filming with a special guest.
Every time you say that, my fucking heart.
I know, this weekend's going to be crazy. We've got so many amazing guests lined up. Make sure you give the podcast a 5-star review. Hit the follow button, it really helps us out. Matt, wishing you and Owasa the best. There's one race left.
Everyone go follow Matt on Instagram.
So PhysioMD on Instagram and Formula Physio on TikTok.
And you've been using TikTok as well?
Well, I'm a newbie.
Let's get Matt to 10K on Instagram. He deserves it. And everyone check out his content because it's fucking interesting.
Yeah, we'll leave all the links down below. Once again, thank you very much for listening to the Pit Stop Podcast. And we'll be back on Thursday, or maybe before with two big guests.
Maybe with a bonus guest, but we don't know yet.
It's not even a bonus, it's
two bonus
F1 guests. Drivers. Did I give too much away?
Yeah, I think everyone knows already.
Okay. All right. Bye.